So I will be talking today about some aspects of dynamics in nearly ADS2 space. So my objective is to convey to you the simplicity of gravitational dynamics in ADS2. And it is this simplicity that we are trying to describe using complexity. Anyway, before I get into this discussion, I'm going to just remind you of a simple toy model for chaotic system, so that it's well known to all of you. So that's a particle on H2, so hyperbolic space. So you have hyperbolic space, say you have hyperbolic disk, and you have a particle, so it follows some geodesic trajectory in hyperbolic space. If you perturb it slightly, it will follow another trajectory. And the two trajectories initially are parallel, and then they start deviating. They deviate in an exponential manner, and in a way that is determined by the geometry of hyperbolic space. It doesn't matter where you start, you always have the same deviation. This deviation is universal. You can think, so there is a growing distance, and if you think that you can, you can also say that the unitary steps that you need to go from one distance to one point to the other also grows in the same way. If your elementary gates only move you a little bit in hyperbolic space, you also get this growing complexity. You can make this finite by taking the volume of hyperbolic space finite, making a quotient by some discrete subgroup. And if you choose this discrete subgroup appropriately, the particle in most, the typical particle will feel as if it is in the hyperbolic space. Okay, so that's a toy model. Now, I'm going to try to describe a real thing. Okay? So real thing is the dynamics dynamics of near ADS3. Now, you think that's not real, but I think this is more real than most things.
Most things that can exist
in the sense of previous stuff. it's real in the sense that we have black holes in nature. We have rotating black holes. We have near extremely rotating black holes, so it's not crazy. ADS2 times some deformed sphere is an example of what we are talking about. So this can be embedded into a real theory as near extremal black holes. But the focus of this talk is not phenomenological. It's not to explain the rotating black holes in nature. It's just simply to emphasize the fact that near extremal black holes have some aspects of the gravitational physics near the horizon which are extremely simple. And they can be modeled by focusing on only two of the dimensions, the radial direction and time. So we're only going to focus on time and the radial direction, and it's justified to go from our own four dimensions to these two dimensions. But again, my motivation is not phenomenological, it's just the incredible simplicity of gravitational dynamics in this case. In this situation, the dynamics can be captured by something that is improperly called dilaton gravity. I'm going to try to break with tradition. I know tradition carries very heavy weight, and I'm going to call it entropion gravity.
So you have a near extreme of black hole. Is that part of this definition of near, or is it just anything that's close to it?
Yeah, so the near extreme of black hole can be in high dimensions.
Okay.
But it will have ADS2 times something.
Oh, okay.
And the relevant dynamics will involve only fields that propagate in ADS2.
Oh, okay.
And all the other dimensions are Kaluza-Klein reduced, so there are some other fields that propagate in this ADS2. So this is some action that contains one obvious piece, which we can call S0 times, this is the most naive action that we can write down, which is simply the two-dimensional version of Einstein's action. But this turns out to be a topological invariant, especially when we add the given Hopping boundary term. And so this is just a number. When we consider the Euclidean black hole, just a number. At that number, it's 2 pi or 4 pi, this coefficient is the extremal entropy, so the value of the extremal entropy of the black hole. So this is not an interesting part, but important for the whole physics. And then there is a second part, which contains, again, a term like that, so R plus 2 times this entropy on field, S of X. And this simple act, this field is representing the fact that in the higher, when we come from higher dimensions, it's representing the area of the transverse sphere that we cannot take it completely constant as we are taking it here. That would give us just the extremal entropy, but we should allow it to vary a little bit. So that's an any action we can somehow expand. So total area in the transverse dimension would be, we'll call it S, would be S0 plus this S of X. Okay. So the area is growing. We call it the entropy on field because it turns out that when you solve the equations and you look at the black hole solution, the actual entropy is given by this, the value of this field at the horizon. Okay, and here it's again important to put the boundary term, and we are going to consider, so when you solve the equations, this field acts as a Lagrange multiplier that implies that the metric is ADS2, so S of X you integrate, you get the Lagrange multiplier. The metric is completely rigid in this approximation, you just have ADS2, no perturbation of the metric. But if you then solve the questions from this field will grow and will not be invariant under the symmetries of radius. And so it's important to put some boundary conditions. So we are going to have ADS2 for a while. Well, ADS2, but we are going to put some boundary conditions at some large value of the radius. And at that value, we are going to fix the value of this field. So we're going to put some boundary condition, and eventually we take that boundary condition to be somewhat large. So that's the action. And as we said, we can view this as a Lagrange multiplier, and then that sets this to zero. And so after integrating out x, we are left with an action which contains only this extrinsic curvature term. if we consider, for example, the Euclidean situation, so we have the whole hyperbolic disk, which is the Euclidean version of ADS2. And then we'll have some boundary that we'll have some boundary which will be will cut out some region inside this ADS2 space. And the important condition is that there is some degree of freedom in the shape of this boundary. So the shape of this boundary is not this geometry is different than a different cutout geometry, which would be a perfect circle. So we should view the geometries here in the interior. They are locally the same, but they are really different. There are different cutout geometries.
You really mean you're throwing away everything that's outside?
We are throwing away, yeah. Importantly, we are throwing away everything that is outside. So the only relevant part of the geometry that we are considering is this. Okay? So this action is a measure on geometries of this type, which are locally, so after we integrate out x, we always have locally ADS2 space, but this curve has a different extrinsic curvature than this curve.
The curve is not just a regular, it's really a physical image.
Yeah, yeah, it is there. So we're taking here the regulated theory with finite regulator.
What?
Yes.
What's no gradient term? Sorry.
That's a choice for this level is you can feel free to find the metric. So that, yeah, perhaps I should have emphasized that any theory that is near extreme, any near extreme black hole can be described by an action of this type. So it looks like a very specific model, but it's quite general. So it was considered by various people like Yakim and Teitelbaum and Al-Murray and Wojcinski and so on. And of course, here I'm focusing only on the gravitational aspects, but we could also add some matter fields. To leading order, we can ignore this entropy on field and have some matter fields that propagate again on a fixed ADS2 background, and the metric again just ADS2. The focus here would be on the gravitational dynamics.
So, why are you going to get this?
Why am I drawing this? What?
There's just one spatial dimension.
Space-time.
This is space. I'm doing Euclidean space. I can also do Lorentzian space if you like. So this is the global ADS2 course. This is ADS2 space. Hopefully everyone will be familiar with this Penrose diagram of ADS2 space. Is that should I explain more? No. So there is a time direction, and then spatial direction, and here this regulator is following a trajectory roughly like this. So here we're simply, so one possible solution is the circular one, and it becomes this type of trajectory. But we could here consider any other trajectory that we like. So that's the story. Furthermore, in this ADS2 case, we could even consider some kind of infrared wall, right? And so we could consider there's only this portion of the space that lies between the UV boundary. So we're going to call this the UV particle, sometimes called UV brain. It's a bit like a random supernode where we have UV brain. If you don't know what a random supernode does, it matter. This is just a particle that is propagating with some action. The action is that extrinsic curvature, which I'm going to pick up over there. And then we could have some other brain here that is produced by these matter fields. And then we could have just a single-sided configuration, or we could have double-sided configuration.
Is it an important feature of that Lorentz summary that you still have gravity?
Yes, so the here, as I'm about to explain, the all the effects of gravity have to do with the motion of these brains. So we see explicitly from the action that after we integrate this Lagrange multiplier, we just get this piece in the action, which is the extrinsic curvature. And we'll analyze this a little further. So, well, since this is the only term in the action, I'm just going to erase the rest of the action. And we have an action of this kind. Now, it turns out that when you take the circuit to be very large, this action is becoming infinite, so it's often convenient to put the regulator, which is proportional to the proper length, and in order to get solutions which look like what we are saying here, we need to put some mass. So this looks like a massive particle, the action for a massive particle. And then this doesn't look very recognizable, but it is possible to use the same Euler identity, the Euler topological invariant that we discussed before, to rewrite this as the integral of R plus the Euler invariant, which is, let's say, 4 pi or some number. Now, R is constant in virtue of what we are saying, so this is equal to the integral of the area, or just the area. And we can think of this action, which is, this is the area of the enclosed surface. So we have an action, which is just the area of the enclosed surface. And we would get an action of this kind if we had a constant electric field. So if we don't have a constant field strength on this two-dimensional hyperbolic space, we would get an action, which would be the integral of F. And if F is some constant, it would be proportional to the area. So this term, this whole action, then, is equal to the action of a particle in an electric field. So there is an action, a piece of the action which goes like mdl, and another piece that goes like u integral of a.
So the curve then is oriented?
Yes, so here, yes.
So for
this correspondence, you need to put it oriented, but the original one, we only knew that, but it was also oriented in the sense that there was an inside and an outside of the curve. Yeah.
So just to confirm, that's a SB, not a S0?
Yeah, this is SB. This is some the boundary value of this sometimes called, incorrectly called data. I say it's incorrect because it has nothing to do with dilatation. So.
Is this analogy complete, like you have sugar pair production?
No. So we are going to take a limit where we have the mass and the charge be very large. And in that limit, we are essentially suppressing this effect of air production. But you can view this whole in the Euclidean diagram. So this can be viewed as a diagram of air production of just one particle. In that limit that we, and we're going to print it in this limit where we can ignore the quantum field theory of the particle in the magnetic field. So think of this as a relativistic particle, but then treat it in the non-relativistic approximation. So you have the particle from the very beginning. Okay, so we have this particle in the electric field, and that's why we are following this trajectory, right? This is an accelerated trajectory in ADS2. The geodesic trajectory would be one that, let's say, stays here in the center or oscillates around the center. So that those are geodesic trajectories. This is an accelerated trajectory, characteristic for particles whose mass is slightly less than its charge. So as I was saying in response to Eva's question, we are going to work in the limit where we are taking M and Q infinity and keeping this fixed. So this is the type of limit we and when we think about it this way, in the context of gauge gravity duality, the field theory time or the boundary time is just the proper time along this GDC, along this trajectory.
It looks like the force is repulsive.
Yeah, the force, yeah. Well,
so if it was a really electric field, it would be attractive.
Well, the electric field pushes this particle this way, and the gravitational field pushes it that way.
Well, where is the electric field?
The electric field is everywhere. Yeah. So if we have an F rho T here, yeah, everywhere, and if you view it,
I have two charges, but the electric field between them, of course, would be all together.
Yeah, yeah. It's not that there was no electric field outside, and now no. Here, that there is imagine this background electric field. Right, not produced by the charges. There is a background electric field. Yeah. And this is a probe charge that is moving in the presence of this background electric field. And it is pushing it's the same thing that wanted to create this pair of particles. So it's pushing the two particles apart. Okay, so if you think of the electric field acting this way.
In the higher dimensional theory, can I think of this as the remnant of an extremal isomer stream?
No, it has nothing to do with that. Like, this is just, let's say, an artifact. Well, it's just a way of rewriting this action and the mathematical equivalence. Just to relate it to something that you know. Okay, so now I was mentioning that all gravitational dynamics is related to that, but there is one important, it's related to the motion of this particle. But there is one little caveat, which is the following. So we could consider, for example, this pair of trajectories, right? Or we could apply an SL2R transformation and shrink one of them and consider this other pair of trajectories, right? So these two differ by an overall SL2R transformation, where we shrank this time and expanded that time. So these two should be considered as completely equivalent configurations. So they are both in the thermal field double configuration, and we should identify them. So gravitational physics, it's equivalent to the dynamics of the unit particle, but up to some global SL2R identification. So any two configurations that differ by a global SL2R transformation should be identified. This should remind you a little bit of what Douglas mentioned in his talk, of there was a global SL2R symmetry that had to be identified. So all that matters is the relative distance, for example, between these two boundaries. And in this case, even though it doesn't appear from the diagram, the relative minimal distance between these two boundaries is the same, for example. Now let's do some more interesting examples. So as I was hinting at this is the thermal field double configuration. And we can, for example, throw some particle into the thermal field double. So we are imagining that there are some fields that propagate in the bulk. Those are the matter fields that we were having in this section. And so we send in some matter field. Okay. The matter fields move in a rigid ADS2 space. They don't modify the geometry of the ADS2 space in any way. So those matter fields just go in. And here, we can think of this as really a process where we have one particle that decays into two other particles. So we'll have one of these particles, it emitted, let's say, this massless particle, and then it decayed into this other one, and in this process, it got a little kink in the... So since we had some momentum, let's say, going into the interior, so we can think of really here the momenta in this two-dimensional space of these particles. So this particle got the momentum in this direction, so the other one got pushed in the other direction. And so now the trajectory of this particle will be different, and it will be go like this. And so now the horizon is not going to be here. So the horizon is defined by all the boundary of the points that can send the signal to the particle. And because this particle reaches infinity earlier, now the horizon has moved. And this you can view as the gravitational back reaction of this particle causing the growth of the horizon of this black hole. So in particular, if you had here some other, let's say, probe particle that was moving here, if you send this particle, then you would not be able to see this particle anymore.
The entropy not play a role in this?
What?
Does the, what do you want me to call it, the entropy?
Yeah.
Does it not play a role in?
No. So you can, so here in this action, we've got rid of that field completely. And we are just looking at the motion of the particle, the motion of this UV particle. You can reintroduce the field and solve for the equations of motion of the field. It's just completely determined by constraints. It has no dynamics. And you can use it to calculate the value of the entropy and so on. But,
it is coupled.
Well, in the approximation, I written it's not coupled. But
even if it were, you could still
well, if it were, then you cannot remove it completely, but it would be
dynamical. It's not dynamical.
Something important is that this entropic field is not propagated. It's a Lagrange multiplier at some level, and then, as any other Lagrange multiplier, the other equations of the variables determine the value of the Lagrange multiplier, and it so happens that it gives you the entropy of the black hole.
Sorry, if you didn't have arbitrary couple of fluid,
well, but then you could remove it by field by definition. So the invariant statement is that there isn't an additional propagating field associated.
Well, strictly speaking, a particle moving would get dressed by it.
Well, so you see, I'm here describing the physics without ever talking about this field. Okay, and it is in this description that the physics is particularly simple. Now, you could have an alternative. So you could also solve for the value of the field and so on, and then when you process this matter, you would get some corrections to this equation. And, well, you can do all that, but it's not necessary for anything I'm going to say. Yeah.
This solution you've written down is assuming that the electric field is stronger than the gravitational field. If it
yes,
weren't, then they would yes. hit. Is that the corresponding meaning there?
No. So the situations that have a gauge gravity dual and so on are the cases that you mentioned, yeah, where the indeed the mass is less than the charge, so electric field is bigger. Yeah.
Question?
Yes.
But will that not change the regulator, the MBL term? Because when you integrate out the entropy, it was sensitive to the boundary condition, the SB
yeah.
term.
Yeah.
And now since wouldn't
this is a constant, right? This is just a constant.
Yeah, but the second term, which acts like a regulator, wouldn't that change?
No, that's again independent of the field S. That's independent of the field S. Okay, so then another thing that you can consider is a situation where, for example, you have a boundary, and let's imagine that you again send some excitation here, and then you evolve backwards in time, and again, as you evolve backwards in time, the trajectory will diverge, right? So this divergence of the trajectory is again a geometrical effect due to the geometry of ADS2. So it's the same as what we had in hyperbolic space, except that it's happening in ADS2 space. But the basic notion is the same. And if you were considering, for example, an expectation value of some operators at a particular time, there would be a growing distance between these 2 points. And this expectation value will start becoming less and less if you move this point further and further to the future.
I mean, if the free geodesics converge rather than diverge, so why do these diverge? Or?
No, the diverge, sorry. So here I'm imagining we evolve the system forwards, and then we evolve it backwards in time. So initially they were following back in the footsteps of the forwards in time evolution, but it's becoming more and more separated. Massive geodesics in ADS2 converge.
Right.
But here we have the electric field that makes it diverge. Because the electric field is more dominant, that effect dominates, and indeed you have diversion trajectories.
Is the electric field bigger? I mean, you have m squared bigger than q squared, I guess, but the electric field is big. Yeah, it's all is minor.
So all these pictures are consistent with this inequality. Sorry for confusing. So here we have this exponential growth of, exponential, let's say, decrease of this correlator. And this effect grows exponentially with time. So the distance grows exponentially with time. And that's just the geometry of ADS2. And of course, this is the phenomenon that we are then interpreting as chaos in the dual boundary theory. But the whole physics in this space is just very analogous to the physics of a particle in hyperbolic space. Okay, and now I'll move on.
I'm confusing as long as it asked. It seems to be the electric field that's doing all the work here.
Yeah.
And yet you're saying it's the geometry.
Well,
it's not
really.
The electric field is just an alternate interpretation of the graph.
Yeah. The gravity is a scalar.
It is, because the electric field is constant, these trajectories are geometrically defined, fixed by the geometry of the space, and you will have even the same effect in flat space. So even if you have flat space with a constant electric field, you will have similar trajectories, and indeed that's a model for black holes, for generic black holes. So the generic black hole is all the same story in flat space, and for these near extreme of black holes, but there you have to work a little more to justify the picture. But here it's a little more natural, and you have,
the confusion is
that we're
just
getting a 2D
geometry,
you have these
masses.
Yes.
But it has a scalar background.
Yeah, so this scalar background doesn't do anything to the matter that moves in, and in particular doesn't do anything to this UV particle. That we're discussing. So the UV particle is sensitive to the presence of this electric field, and it's moving with constant acceleration. It's geometric in the sense that we have the geometry of this circle that fixes the geometry of these two lines, right? And it's fixing the acceleration of these two lines. And when we talk about the diversions and so on, it's again given by geometric effects in the sense, perhaps I can make this a little more precise. So, it's geometric in the sense that these two trajectories just differ by an SL2R transformation. So we take this trajectory and this momentum that this kick that we got implies that so we have this trajectory get called kick, but the shape of the trajectory of all possible trajectories is basically essentially always the same, and they differ only by an SL2R transformation. So the reason this distance is growing is just purely from the group theory of SL2R. So in that sense, it is geometric. I'm not sure if I'm...
So it's not a particle in ADS2. It's important that it's this boundary theory.
It's the motion of the UV particle, or it's sometimes called UV brain.
UV brain, exactly.
And it's a particle in ADS2 with electric field. And the trajectory is basically unique.
Right.
Up to a
sub-to-R
transformation.
Particle just in ADS2 period?
No, it's not the massive particle in ADS2. But the that's not the point I would like to emphasize. So the point that I'm trying to emphasize is that the chaos and so on is just a purely geometric effect. It's just due to DSL2R symmetries of this problem. And now, and now I'm going to discuss a little bit the analysis of the traversable worm problem. This is based on a paper listed over there. One of the co-authors is here, Aaron Wald. And I'm going to discuss how that, so they discussed it in a slightly different example, so I'm going to discuss it in this example. So what they considered was they started with the thermofield double, one beloved state. Some people say we love it too much. I think it holds important lessons. It's a very special state, of course, in the same sense that diamond is a special form of carbon. So we start with this state, and we know that if we send a signal from here, this signal cannot get to the other side, right? So this is the signal, maybe I draw the signals with different color. So we have the signal going here to the right-hand side, and it doesn't reach the observer on the right-hand side, and this is perfect. This is an entangled state, that's perfect. So what Gao, Jeffers, and Wald said is, well, let's put some interaction here at equal to zero. So we started with the thermofield double state. Hopefully you remember from previous talks, it's expression in the boundary theory. Then we are acting with an interaction which contains a left and a right operator at the origin. So these operators are simple operators that correspond to the insertion of the bulk quantum field. When you insert these operators, these operators have a non-trivial correlator. So one approximation to the dynamics here is to say that, well, we'll get something that will be essentially the expectation value of these operators. All that happens is that this thermofield double gets this extra phase. So that's one approximation to the dynamics. And so here also in the bulk, we can approximate the dynamics of the UV particles by saying, okay, we are putting some interaction between these two particles, and this interaction has some expectation value. That's some classical function. But this expectation value depends on the distance between these two UV particles. So there is some bulk quantum field, and in the bulk, the correlations of the quantum field decay with the distance. Right? So as we move further, it's less correlated. Okay. So that implies that these two bulk UV particles will have some force, right? So they will feel a force, and the force will be attractive or repulsive because depending on what the sign of G is. And it's clear that you can choose a sign of G that makes the force attractive.
This is just an impulsive force.
This is a force that exists at this time, so if you make this last longer, it will exist for a longer time. But for our purposes, it's enough that it exists for some time. So if you have this attractive force, then again you will get a small kick to these trajectories, but it's an inward kick. And the inward kick will make these trajectories follow, there would be a little bit delay in their outward motion, and so now they can receive this signal. Okay, so in this way we see that here the gravitational dynamics is so simple that it's very easy to understand why this is happening. Now, why is this interesting? Well, since we introduce some interaction between the two sides, it's of course not surprising that we can send a signal. So you should not be surprised by the fact that you can send a signal. But you should be surprised by the manner in which the signal is sent. So you should be, it's interesting that you put this interaction and you might have thought, okay, if I move something here, there would be the resulting effect on the right-hand side could be a whole mess, right? Mess this up, then I put. It is important that the signal you are sending could be any operator, so let's call it phi, and the one you are correlating could be any other. Let me denote the operators on the field in the bulk by the same letter. So you here correlate using one kind of field. Here it's a completely different field. The propagation of the signal is completely universal in the sense that here you can send all possible fields you have in the theory. They are independent of the field you put in here. The signal gets to the right after some while. Right? So here the interaction happens at t equal to zero. And then for a bunch of times, you don't see anything. And then suddenly, you see the signal. Okay. So there is a time delay. So it really looks like something is going through the interior. Right? So if you were purely boundary observer, you would see all these features. So this universality is hinting us that these signals are probing some underlying space-time. Right? They are measuring all the same time. They're all, usually we define time as what the clock measures. And the important thing is that all clocks measure the same time, and so here all signals are measuring the same space time. Also, notice that you have
your picture makes it look like I could have just given the right particle location and still received the signal.
Yes, but the question is how can it, yeah, it is true, but this is not possible to give the right particle location with an SL2R invariant interaction. So you can give kicks that correspond to for example emitting a particle. Those kicks, sorry, maybe I said something there. So if you emit, what kind of kicks can you give? So you can emit a particle, right? And that gives an outward kick. Or you can absorb a particle from the vacuum, that will give a kick in the other direction.
But first you have to have that particle.
And if you didn't have that particle, you cannot do that. So here you are using, you are in some sense absorbing that particle from the vacuum that was emitted from here. Right? You're using that virtual interaction to give you this inward kick. Okay. Now, you can wonder, so is this a strange effect? So for example, suppose you had two cups of water. So here I have two cups of water. Now, I tell you that, let's say about 10 seconds, there will be the thermal field double. So they are classical systems, let's say. The thermal field double for a classical system would be all the particles in the same location and with opposite velocities. Okay. And then I take one cup and I tap it here, here where the cup is. I just make a tap just in this position. Right? And let it go for a while, right? 10 seconds. And now I put some interaction between the two cups. I just touch them at some other location. Now I give some cup to Lenny, and now 10 seconds later, he's going to be surprised if he hears the same tap in this. This is the other cup, no, not the, the one. I made the tap in this one. Would you be surprised if you see that tap in, you heard it after 10 seconds? You did hear it. That's what's happening here. Happening in this situation.
So it gets slower than sound communications instead of faster than light?
Well, the important point is that we only touching the cups means that the amount of information that got transferred was small. Right? It was a few qubits were transferred. But nevertheless, the signal that we had initially put in, which had nothing to do with the degree of freedom that got some interaction, right? That signal went through, and Lenny was able to hear it with his finger. Okay. So the question is, what are examples of systems that do this? And there is a system, a simple system, that does this. And that's this SYK model that Douglas Stanford described in his talk. And I won't review all of it. I'm only going to say that it involves n Majorana fermions. So it's a system with a finite number of degrees of freedom. There is some chain of reasoning that involves first defining some function two times, which is just the expectation value, the average expectation value of these fermions. At different times. And there's a reformulation of the theory where the fundamental variable is this variable. And then there is a further low energy limit that gives a certain Schwarzian action that Douglas explained. So it gives some Schwarzian action which involves the reparametrization of time. So some action roughly of this form. Now, it turns out that this action is, again, equivalent to the action of this UV particle in the limit that the mass and the charge are very large, a very tiny difference. So this action can be reinterpreted, in other words, as the motion of one of these UV particles in ADS2. This is just, if you wish, a mathematical equivalence, mathematical relationship between these two actions. But what this means is that, is there a question? Anyway, so, Lenny knows who he should ask the question. So, because this is mathematically equivalent to this problem of a particle moving in, moving at the boundary of ADS2, that turns out to imply also that all the facts that we compute using gravitational physics in ADS2, we are going to be able to reproduce here in the SYK model using this action, using this description. In particular, so the chaos effect we discussed this traversability of the wormhole, that also can be reproduced in this way. So just let me say the words so that I'm going to look at this picture, but imagine the thermofield double of SYK. So each line is just an SYK timeline. So we do a perturbation here. We send some fermion, let's say psi1. Here, we put some interaction. Some fermion, let's say psi2. Okay. Technically, we have to put many fermions to make things a little simpler, but forget about that. And then, when we do this, we initially started out with a classical solution of this action. And then, when we put this interaction, there will be a kick to both the phi left and the phi right. So phi left, right, right. So they start out in the just the vacuum configuration, vacuum solution, and these interactions will kick them a little bit. And it will kick them in such a way that when we compute this correlator, the effect on this correlator is going to be a time reparametrization, right? A time reparametrization of this correlator that is effectively putting this correlator in a causally accessible region compared to this one. So, there is no space, but these correlators, I believe, they are given by conformal symmetry. They are given by, they have a conformal invariant expression, and they are equal to the correlators you would have for fields that propagate in ADS2. So I can use this ADS2 language. It's just for making the connection simpler, but the mathematics of the transformation of coordinates that we need to do is exactly the same as the transformation of coordinates we would do if we were to displace this point to a causally accessible region. So that's what happens in that situation. Okay. So that is also again reproduced in this model. And so one can have a question here. So for example, if we do this, and this involved an interaction that, let's say, was mediated by some operators, and we can produce this interaction by moving some qubits from here to here, but it will be a finite number, a small number.
So these operators are not totally local because they cut off the same interaction?
Well, we're in quantum mechanics, so they're local. They're just local. Yeah, they're local in time. And they're, but if you want, you can spread them over a time which is further than the temperature. So okay, so. So we would like to understand the fact that we cannot send a huge amount of information. So what will limit the amount of information we can send here? And what will limit this is that if we send too much information here, we'll need to send a lot of momentum, right? So each qubit will send it some momentum. And that will affect the trajectory of that of the left UV particle. And again, so now it should be a familiar story. What will happen? It gets tilted, right? It gets displaced this way. And then when we put this interaction, you'll find that these two points are now further than they were before. Further means that this correlation will be smaller, the force will be smaller, and so it will not be able to move this this particle. Instead of following this trajectory, well, it will be moved a little bit, but not maybe nearly enough to be able to send the information. Okay. So that there you see that the effect is completely geometric, and you can write down a formula for the correlation function between phi left and phi right that takes into account this effect. And it's very easy to write it down. It has to do, one has to basically implement this picture in the formulas. But I guarantee you that it's no difficulty to implement these pictures in the formulas. If you want, I can write that formula. You want the formula?
Let's see it.
Yeah.
It's always someone.
Just don't trust you.
Yeah. Well, let's start writing the correlator. Okay, so we have the correlator between phi left and phi right in the absence of any effect. So that's 1 over the space-time distance here and so on. So let's set that to 1 because we put them at opposite points in the thermofield level. Okay, it's like this. But well, we'll write that one in momentum space. Hopefully what I'm saying is, I'm going to ignore i's and 2 pi's and so on. So this is the correlator, right, where keep in mind, so we are going to express the correlators in terms of, we are going to decompose the correlator in terms of as a sum over states that have definite p minus. We could have done in any way. So the number that appears here is the distance between the two. If we were to shift the times, it would appear. Okay. So that's the correlator without anything. And the correlator we are interested in is one in which we are inserting this perturbation. So OO and then phi right e to the I g OO. Phi left. Okay. Now, in this expression, we can act basically on the placing the thermofield W on the left, and we can argue that this will just give us a phase e to the minus ig. I'm going to set the OO correlator again to 1. I'm setting the temperature to 1. That's why all this. So we are going to get this, and then we'll have this other piece, which will be a more non-trivial expression. And this is, again, the same correlator, but evaluated in a state, this two-point function. And we're going to decompose. So here this moved out and became an e to the ig. Now we are at this stage. And we're going to decompose this into states with given momentum. And so we're now going to evaluate this correlator in a background with this fixed momentum. So, but what was the effect of momentum? The effect of putting momentum was to do a rotation of this trajectory. And the rotation of that trajectory is to make a relative SL2R transformation, we call it H, between here the left and the right correlators. And so the whole effect is that now this expectation value will have an insertion of a particular SL2R transformation. What is that SL2R transformation? Well, it's equal to basically something that has to do with, well, the G Newton, or some small coupling, which is somehow the heaviness of this particle is not kicked so easily. It's an effect that grows with time. That's the amplification factor of the fact. Yeah. Okay, so that's, and then some P plus operator, and times the P minus. So the bigger the P minus, the bigger the effect. So this is some kind of X plus translation. This is similar to the shockwave displacements that we get across the shockwave. That's the same story. And in the end, we get the formula for this correlator that we're computing. So this came from the wave functions from these two pieces, which are the same as that, including this factor. And now we're going to put here the e to the ig and the correlator. So the correlator was essentially representing 1, but now it will be different than 1 by this g newton into the t times minus b minus. My convention is b minus is negative, sorry. So that's the final formula, and there was an e to the minus ig. So this takes into account the back reaction, where b minus is very large. This effect somehow kills this term, which was responsible for the traversability. Now, the first order expression comes from, so the original gravity result that I was describing in the beginning comes from expanding this, so imagine that this is small, but g is large, so that the product of g times this is appreciable. And then that is acting again as a kind of displacement of the x minus direction, and that's what was given this traversability effect. Okay, and this is just remarks in the formula. And this this you can plot what this function is, and so to leading order, we were getting some effect. So this is time. And then we were, let's say we have this correlator. So the correlator is non-trivial, but the commutator between phi left and phi right, in the presence of the interaction, is equal to the imaginary part, proportional to the imaginary part of this correlator. So in the leading approximation, there was no effect up to some time, and then there was some non-trivial commutator. That was the leading approximation. If you include this whole thing, there is some non-trivial commutator even at early times, and so you have some function which does something like this. And one interesting aspect is that even after a very long time, you will still get a non-trivial effect that is a kind of interference effect between two different orders in the commutator, or you could say that between the case where you do send the signal and do not send the signal. So you can still send the signals in that case. I don't have time to go into the details. Did I start on time or did I start?
Yes.
I think I started like 20 minutes late. I'm near black hole, there's a red shift. Hopefully some information is getting to you.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah, sure.
It's not even a question. It's a question. The interpretation of that picture in terms of water cups is not right. What you said is you take the two water cups, put them in the thermal field bubble state.
Yeah.
That's the state in the middle.
Yes. Yeah.
And then tap it.
No, I didn't say that. I said they will be in a thermal field bubble in 10 seconds.
Yeah. Well, in other words, you had to take a precursor that ran you backward, and then tap it, and then run
it. When I started the discussion, I said in 10 seconds, it will be in the thermal field bubble.
Yeah,
then
exactly.
You tap it.
Exactly.
Then
it will be right, so you set up an initial condition, which was rather, you set up an initial condition, which was sort of guaranteed.
Yes, indeed. This is a very special
thing. Nothing magic happened.
Yes, well, do you think it will happen in a cup of water?
Yes.
Okay.
If you could run the cup of water backwards,
yes.
Tap it, and then...
Yes, okay, well, you have the right answer.
Yeah.
Is it obvious to everyone that it will happen in a cup of water?
No, but this is very universal, though, right? Like, doesn't it matter here that there's a bulb where you can sort of... You know, however the tapping is doing, it doesn't matter what you make the signal out of, right? Like, the same tap allows you to send many different things through. That's not true with a cup of water, right?
One, it will happen with a cup of water, but you have to be very careful.
But I set up the condition. So if you make a tap in any place in the Kappa border,
yeah,
you make an interaction in any other place in the Kappa border.
Yeah, but even if you didn't make the interaction, you'd have this odd thing that the signal coherently just appears just behind the horizon.
Yes, yes. So the feature of the signal appearing in a completely undeformed way is very special to the gravity situation.
That's right. And had you made any little perturbation after that, you would have destroyed it. You would have had a chaotic effect which would have destroyed it. So you say, would it happen with a cup of water? Probably not, because just a bombarding by one atmospheric atom would have ruined it.
Well,
I think it depends on which side. I mean, at least in the traversable worm, in the case of the BTZ black hole that my group looked at, if you send something in, try to send something in the future in the same direction, it's not a problem. But if you try to send something in the opposite direction,
the problem is something here would delay the signal.
Yeah.
But we were talking about isolated cups of water. Okay, before I talk more about the cups of water, let me just mention the connection between this and the Hayden and Pressfield discussion that was also mentioned before. Maybe why is this related to Hayden and Pressfield? So Hayden and Pressfield had a black hole and then a quantum computer. Here Bob was at the quantum computer and Alice had a black hole. They were perfectly entangled and in a known entangled state. Alice sends a qubit into the black hole. Then Bob gets some other pieces of Hawking radiation and fits it into the quantum computer and does something. And out comes Alice's qubit. Let me call it A, Alice's qubit. Okay. And this was supposed to be mysterious because the Alice qubit would be both here and behind the horizon and so on. Now here we see a way of doing this would be to, in the quantum computer, simulate or create the thermofield level of this black hole. And in that case, the interpretation would be this particular diagram. And this of course, the Alice message is this. These qubits that are sent between the two sides are the ones that are necessary to establish this correlation. And then what we see is that, what has happened is essentially the signal has moved from here to somehow a region that is causally accessible. And one important point that I guess Douglas mentioned last time is that the qubit or the information is here now in both sides, but it's not anymore in the interior. It's not in the interior of any black hole. There's no complementarity or anything like that. The signal that was inside has moved outside. Okay. Now back to the cups of tea.
The one picture that you drew there, the photon that went from the black hole, really sort of went around the outside.
Yeah. This is also going around the outside here.
Yeah.
You know, in order to establish this interaction,
right,
we need to somehow have some communication.
Yeah, it's not as if that photon went through the wormhole. No.
What goes through the wormhole is not the photon.
That's
now,
right.
This is crucial. What goes to the wormhole is not the photon, but this signal. It's something else.
So
there is an electron going here, and there's a photon going this way. Okay. The photon makes the electron go through it. Well, it wouldn't work in the case of the electron because it's charged.
Just a comment. In terms of the background causal structure, the signal is at two places at the same time.
I made a small scene here, which was to not describe it in terms of this UV particle. So here the signal is really going through the bulk, right? There is no, it's always at one time. And then what happens is that the boundary trajectory got shifted, and well, now it can reach the signal. So what you would call the new black hole horizon is further in.
No, I understand.
And I misspoke. The electron could go through. Because the relative U1 symmetries, and then it's rotation of charges, not observed in the event. Okay, so back to the caps of T, the interesting point is that this effect also happens for the cap of T. This is again something Douglas noticed. And but Lenin it was obvious, but certainly to me it wasn't obvious. And so I'll try to explain the effect. So we have the two caps of T at time equal to zero, where you have all the molecules at any location. They're exactly the same. So this one, so they're supposed to be two exact copies of each other, but the momenta in one are in one direction and the momenta are in the other direction. We both describe backwards, and we move the position of one molecule, let's say x1. So we move x1, we make a small change on the position of x1 of the left side. And that at time equal to, so then we're at the time equal to zero, we're going to let the x2 variable, so the position of the second part of the graph. So we need to figure out what the position of the second particle is if we move the first particle, and that will be equal to the derivative of the x2 particle at time zero. Respect to the x1 particle at time t. So here I'm imagining t running back to that. And that's equal to the Poisson bracket between x2 at 0 and t1 at t. Okay. All of this is times delta x1. Times delta x1, times delta x1. Okay, so then now here we put some interaction term in the Lagrangian, which is g. Let's say times x2, x2 left, x2 right. What this is putting is it's putting a potential for the x2 particle that is proportional to x2 right. So that means that the momentum of this particle will be changed. So there's some force and it will change the momentum of the x2 particle. And so there will be a change in the momentum of the x2 particle that is proportional to this delta x2. And that will change at later time. The claim is that it will change at later time the momentum of the one particle. Okay. So the one particle at that later time is somewhere. And we change it again by an amount which is proportional to the derivative of the momentum at time t. What we are going to change is, so it caused the change of the, this caused the change of delta p2, and now we're trying to evaluate the change in delta p1 at time t, so all this happens at zero. And that's equal to the derivative of p1 with respect to p2 at zero. And this is actually equal to the same Poisson bracket. So that's equal to exactly the same Poisson bracket. And so the non-trivial observation is that by doing the chain of going from delta p1, so in the end, you will get that delta p1 is equal to the Poisson bracket square times delta x1. So the dynamics is kind of complicated. So these Poisson brackets are doing all kinds of things. But the idea is that the Poisson bracket will appear squared here. And so we'll have a correlation between the momentum at 1 and the position at 1 due to some interaction of some other particle. Notice that the particle that got interaction has nothing to do with the first particle. But we are relying on chaos to propagate the information about this particle to the other particles. Right? So here that is happening even in this classical system. And in some sense it's some amplified, so the small perturbation gets somehow amplified and sends some signal to the other side. So it's a kind of thermofield double amplifier.
What's the time window for this to happen?
Yeah, so the effect, the idea is that this is supposed to happen in the time windows where the commutators are growing exponentially. Right? So the time grows exponentially with some Lyapunov exponent. And then after a while, these commutators become further one. So the effect, this effect is appearing in the region where this, you have this commutator growing.
So once it stops growing, it can't work anymore? gravity case, there seems to be a window.
Yeah, in the
gravity case. Where it can't be too soon and it can't be too late.
Yeah, in the gravity case, there is a window. There is still an effect that happens long before the window, but it's more limited. So the big amplification is happening, gravity is happening at a particular time, which is this time where the signal just hits the other side. There is some smaller effect that exists even for very long times. Yeah?
Can I make a comment about this? So the key point that Juan made here is that this effect is proportional to the square of the Poisson bracket. And that's why you have an interesting effect, because that quantity is positive. But if we're outside this region where the perturbations are very small, then the delta x's and delta p's won't be determined by the Poisson bracket anymore. And the argument that it will be a positive sign won't be true. So that's why at late times the effect becomes small.
So that's the thing that corresponds to the back reaction being too large.
Yeah.
Because you mean the linearization breaks down.
Linearization breaks down, and then you have no argument that the sign is positive.
Yeah.
Also here, it's important that the two times are equal. So if you make the two times different, also it will work.
Juan, is it important that the interaction is symmetric in the rates of freedom that are simply connected in the quantum field?
No. What is really important is, that the interactions, that the variables are interacting are correlated.
So this could have been x2l, x5l.
That wouldn't work because they are not correlated.
Oh, I'm sorry, they are correlated in the thermal field.
Yeah, that's right. We are using the special properties of the thermal field double. Okay, I don't know, this is kind of a fun effect, and maybe it can be used to build an amplifier. I think I'm essentially done. I was going to mention some things in the U1 case, but I think probably do I have some time now? I'm out of time, so I want to say that. But I think just one philosophical remark. Here we're trying to understand the black hole interior and gravity and so on. And this is like a complicated phase of matter. And the question is that it's difficult to see this phase of matter easily from the boundary point of view. So the boundary point of view, where we are trying to ask a certain kind of question, and it's difficult to see this confining phase, gravitational holographic phase. Now, in condensed matter physics, sometimes similar situations are found with these topological phases of matter, like topological insulators. If you are in the bulk, you might not notice you have a topological insulator. Ask the right questions, then you notice, and you can even see them in the lab and so on. So hopefully, looking for understanding this new phase of matter that is gravity will also help us recognize and ask new questions about ordinary situations that will let us find new and interesting effects, like these funny things that the thermal field double is doing. So we thought that this connection between the spatial connection that we have here between left and right may be something much more universal, general systems in thermal field doubles that we haven't really recognized properly yet. Hopefully we'll recognize better in the future.